Now, when did you become a news anchor for WBBM here in Chicago? Was that when you first got here?
Nope. I was a street reporter and a writer in the newsroom. In 2 years, Fahey Flynn retired. John Drury, who was working at Channel 2 at the time, decided that he would leave rather than work for the current news director.
Okay.
And they were kind of stuck. I was a young guy. It looked like I was about 16. I had no business anchoring a major newscast like that in a major market like this. But I got the job.
Mm.
And it was about a year and a half before they moved me out back to the 6 o'clock news.
Okay.
They liked me, but, you know, I really was too young to be doing the 10 o'clock. And so by 1970, after 4 years in Chicago, that's the 1968 year.
Mm-hmm.
Conventions, riots, you know, which
the
was
year
a big
of history.
Deal. Yeah.
Yeah.
I was ready, I felt, to go to the network.
Okay.
And I went as a correspondent. The opening they had was in Los Angeles, so I went to L.A., covered the Manson trial, and there I was really able to use my law degree.
Mm-hmm.
I'd covered the Conspiracy 7 in Chicago. Manson, Angela Davis, Daniel Ellsberg, Juan Corona. I mean, I had quite a string of them. Juan Corona killed 25 itinerant laborers in Yuba City, California. So it was about 1973. CBS saw fit to call me back to Chicago.
Okay.
And came back, teamed up with Walter for 9 years, and then in 82 went to CBS for the morning news.
You know, I was talking to my father-in-law prior to coming here and speaking with you, and I remember sitting with my mother and my sister watching every single day, not missing one day of watching Walter and Bill and Janet Lane Hart.
We had Chris Wallace.
Chris Wallace,
Rene Poussaint and Brent Musburger.
Yes.
I mean, we had so many.
You guys were absolutely legendary. Journalism was a lot different back then than it is now.
Yeah, seemed to be.
It seemed to be more real and more authentic.
Yes. You know, we were, as a matter of fact, that was almost our, that's a good phrase. We're more real and more authentic. We called ourselves, it isn't pretty, but it's real, because we established an anchor desk in the newsroom.
Mm.
We rolled up our sleeves, took off our coats, and I would go outside during the day and continue reporting.
Mm-hmm.
Walter would stay inside and do his perspective.
Mm.
So that there really was this image, which was real, of a working news team. We had a challenge, and that challenge was to break news stories.
Mm.
We knew Chicago had always been this wonderful news town
with
a wonderful newspaper tradition. But in 1973, television news was largely the stepsister of the newspapers. You know, we would go out and shoot what they confirmed was news and put in the paper. So I started a focus unit, started investigative reporting, broke the Agent Orange story, Amerasian kids, started foreign trips to Belfast and South Africa and Rhodesia. Remember that?
Wow.
And Vietnam in 1975, Iran, while the hostages were there in 1982. I mean, it was amazing. And established some new standards, we thought, for local television reporting. Then, as large owners, conglomerates, took over the television networks that owned the news operations, they started running them like a business and began to cut back on report on expenditures and gone with the days.
You were there for nine years.
9 years.
And that's around the Reagan years, isn't it? The Reagan era?
No, I left in 82.
In 82.
I think he started then.
Okay. Because I know Reagan, you know, the broadcast deregulation and all that began, and that's when all of this sensational TV and all of that stuff began.
That's right.
At one point on
that, the day, wondering whether deregulation was good for broadcasting, regulation required, the FCC required a certain amount of programming to be devoted to religious and public opinion, and you had to serve the public to get your license mm-hmm. for the next year, because these were public licenses for the public airwaves. The day after deregulation law hit, all those were wiped out. And instead, we put cartoons in, reruns, syndicated shows, which made money. That's exactly what deregulation did for broadcasting.
And it has not gotten better since, in a sense.
Yeah.
When did you decide to strike out on your own and say, okay, enough is enough. I want to see what it's like to be an entrepreneur and do my own. And you launched Kurtis Productions in 1990?
Well, about 88, but 1990 is when we clicked in with A&E.
Okay.
But I was at the morning news in CBS. Everybody wants to go to the network. Everybody wants to be a network anchor. And I did in 1982, and I had been the correspondent back in 70 to 73. When I got to the top of the mountain, however, the mountain had changed.
And I realized, what you thought was up there wasn't there anymore, right?
I looked around. I said, you know, there isn't a job here I want. And the reason is the evening news, Dan Rather was going to be there for a long time. But he's on 5 minutes a night in a half-hour show. At that time, you know, he couldn't go out and report. He's a great reporter. Couldn't do that. Was just sitting right there, like Walter did. Couldn't write a whole lot. And then 60 Minutes, you're largely a microphone holder.
Absolutely.
The producer is the one who spends time on the story.
Right.
So there weren't a lot of choices. And I said, well, what's left? I've done the local television. Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily want to do that. I said, well, documentaries. I've always liked long-form documentaries. At the time, in 1985, documentaries were dead. There was no such thing. They were wiping out whole floors on network buildings in the networks because the documentaries didn't make the ratings. And so they didn't want to spoil a programming flow in prime time by sticking in a show by the news division that wouldn't, and it's still the case today. Yeah, there used to be these white papers and the Pentagon papers and wonderful, groundbreaking documentaries. Networks don't do them anymore. They concentrate on news magazines. 60 Minutes had a lot to do with that because 60 Minutes with three stories in an hour is the highest rated news show and very often the highest rated show on television because people will watch. Well, that was the new kind of quasi-documentary. Longer stories, but in a form that was easier to take, hence higher ratings. So I said, if I'm going to do documentaries, I'm going to have to do them myself. I'll go back to Chicago if I can negotiate a contract, start my own company, and sell my product, which was the documentary. And then what I will take credit for is that at the time, there was no outlet. There was no daylight out there. I didn't. I had faith that something would happen. That I would be able. That if it was good enough, I would be able. You know, you build it and they will buy.
They will come. They will buy. Right.
So, you know, I've been a reporter for 25 years.
Right.
I wasn't a businessman.
Right.
I didn't have an MBA, and so I said, I'm going to set aside 2 years and let it be on-the-job training. I'll put my own money up.
Okay.
I didn't know how much it cost to rent the gear that I had been using at CBS for free.
Right.
And that situation exists today. I didn't know I really had to have a place. I said, well, why can't everybody work out of their house? I didn't know anything about health.
The word green comes to mind.
Yeah, I think so. I learned that real fast in about a week.
Wow.
Health plan. You know, I mean, goodness. Great. Taxes. So it took a while.